Good morning, church, and welcome to the online worship experience for New Philadelphia First United Methodist Church. I am Pastor Brandon, and I am excited that you are joining us for worship this morning. As we begin worship, I've got just a few announcements to share with you. The first announcement is that we are starting to reopen a little bit more each and every week. And this week, the clothes closet reopened on Wednesday evening. What this means is that not only can people come and get clothes on Wednesdays, we can also accept donations for this ministry. However, I would ask you to consider that when you bring your donation, if the box for the donations is full, we would ask you to consider coming back another time to make that donation. We've been having issues with people leaving bags of clothes on the ground outside of that donation box, which exposes those clothing items to the weather and makes it so that it could be difficult for us to use them in that ministry. So please, if the donation box is full, please come back another time to make your donation. Another announcement that I have is just a reminder that Vacation Bible School will be happening this summer in July, and it will be in the exact same way that we're doing this worship service. There are people who are diligently putting together Vacation Bible School kits that you will be able to come and get to take home to go through the VBS experience with your kids or grandkids or whoever else is there with you. Also, last week we had given an update about what we are doing to be able to join in what we call face-to-face worship. In other words, coming back here for worship on Sunday mornings. We had asked you to consider making a special donation to help us defray the unexpected costs that we are incurring for trying to reopen. If you feel compelled, please make your check out to the church, but in the memo, let us know that it is for face-to-face worship. Also, at the end of this worship service, there'll be another update about what we are doing to be able to bring people back into this space on Sunday mornings. The final thing that I have is to say, today is Father's Day, and we would like you to consider the blessings that we've all experienced from our God, and the blessings specifically surrounding having a dad. Now, of course, dads aren't perfect, but they're still a blessing, and they should be somebody we should be thanking. And so today we set this time aside, we set this worship experience aside just to remember how important it is that we have our fathers. Now, I would say, if you can give your dad a hug, go for it. Now, my son said, Dad, we're supposed to social distance. Well, use your own judgment. But let us remember that we are often who we are because of the love and the dedication and the hard work of our fathers. And so on this Father's Day, I just want to say a big thank you out there to all of the dads. Now, with all of that being said, let us prepare for worship. You know, I want to tell all of you that I do miss having us gather together for in-person worship. You see, there are certain parts of our worship experience that just, they don't feel right all the time because they demand that people are participating and people are here. This is the case with the Lord's Prayer. When we gather together, we share our joys and concerns, and we end that time by praying the prayer together. And there's just something missing. However, I also have to say that this is take number two of this time of prayer. You see, one of the things that can happen when you're recording a service and preparing it is that occasionally a vehicle with a siren goes by. And it's really loud. And the beauty about this is that I could stop and I could start over. Of course, though, I understand that that person in that ambulance or police car that just drove by, that they're first responders. And so I pray for whatever emergency that they're going to right now, knowing that no matter what, no matter when, there are people out there doing that. So like this morning, I will pray and I'll thank God for them. But I encourage you as well, thank God for our first responders. But not just that. Let's take this time to use this tool, this time of prayer, to grow closer to God. As I pray, empty your heart. Ask God to enter in, to clear out that clutter that might be in there, the things of this world that draw us away from God. Invite God in to transform you, to transform this world. With that being said, would you join me for a word of prayer? Oh, holy God, we gather for a time of worship and a time of praise, knowing that you are in our midst and you are with us. Sometimes it can be different because, especially right now, things are different. We're all in different places, not just physically, but we're also all in different places spiritually. For some, we've come to know Jesus Christ very recently. For others, we've known him all of our lives. For all of us, though, there's more for us to learn. And so we come before you just humbly now, asking for your wisdom and your understanding. We see that in this world there are so many people, and there are many that are serving our communities, and we are thankful for them, knowing that each one of them will enter into times where there might be an emergency, times where they're not sure what is going on. We pray for your wisdom to be there for them, to help them to assess this situation and to make decisions that would be honoring of you. And so, Lord, we lift those up, those individuals up. But it's not just the first responders. It's not just the medical professionals. We want to lift those that we love up, because there are those that we're concerned about, those who are sick, those who are dealing with health issues, those who are dealing with challenges in this life that are just overwhelming. Heavenly Father, we pray that you would be with each of those that we love, each of those that we're concerned about, each of those for whom our hearts break, that we know that when there are those who are hurting unnecessarily, you are also so concerned. For those that we can go and serve, for those who you would have us serve, we pray that you would prepare us, that you would open up our eyes to those needs that are presented before us, so that we might be Christ to the world. Now, we do come before you humbly, knowing that we are sinners. We have failed often to do what you would have us do. We ask for forgiveness, but we also ask for guidance so that we might be changed and transformed, so that we might be living as the children that you had called us to be. Now, we do all of this today because of your Son, Jesus Christ. We have accepted him as our Lord and Savior. Remind us today of that acceptance. Remind us of what that truly means, as we would join together this morning to pray the way that you have taught us, the way that your Son has taught us, when we pray, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen."
My name is Kyler Keck. I worship in the second service. And for special music, I'll be playing "Love Divine, All Loves Excelling."
I want to take a moment to talk to the kids right now and share a message. Now, this message actually, it comes from the scripture that I'm using in the sermon today. And so come closer, because this is for you guys, all you little ones right now. You see, the scripture that I use is from the letter to the Ephesians. It's towards the back of the Bible in the New Testament. And I'm only going to read you one verse. This is from chapter 5, verse 15. The rest of the church, they get a lot more verses, but this is the one I want to look at. It says, "Be careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise." Okay, now, let me say this. So much of our faith in God and in Jesus is about how we are going to live, that we're supposed to be good, we're supposed to be nice, we're supposed to serve other people. And actually, that scripture, it says that we're supposed to be wise, not unwise. Well, you might be sitting there going, well, what does that really mean to be wise? Now, wise has something to do with knowledge and understanding. You see, I can read a book to you and give you all sorts of facts. I can tell you things that are right and wrong. But you know, that's only knowledge. You see, being wise actually means that you take that knowledge, you take those facts, you take those things, and you put them into practice. So the passage tells us that we should be careful that when we live and when we act, that we seek to be wise. So you know what that really means? That means more than anything that we need to learn about what is good and we need to learn about what is bad. So that way when we act and when we do things, we can make sure that we are engaging in behaviors that are good. As I said earlier though, things that would be good might be loving our neighbor or serving one another or being there for somebody who is in need. Now, of course, to get this knowledge, we really need somebody to help us learn these things. Sometimes we might just learn it by reading the Bible, but sometimes that's a really tough thing to do because we're still learning how to read and learning a lot of those bigger words. So if that's an issue, all we have to do is go to those who love us and say, hey, can you help me learn these things? Can you give me the information that will help me make good choices? Because that's what it means to be wise, is being able to take that information and then making the best decisions and to make the good decisions. So today, this week, when you're doing stuff, when you're playing or when you're doing things with your family, if you're at all confused or wondering, am I doing what is right? Am I doing what is good? Am I doing what is wise? You know, one of the easiest things to do would be just simply to go to mom and dad, to go to grandma and grandpa, to go to those who love us and say, hey, I need some help here because I want to make sure that as I live, I'm being wise. Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have given us your word to show us the way. But you know, we understand that it can't be just that you've given us that word. We have to read it, we have to learn it, we have to understand it, and then we have to put it into practice. That's a tall order. So we just pray today, Lord, that you would give us not only that information and that wisdom, but you'd make it possible for us actually to live it out. Lord, we thank you for your word, and we ask for your blessing in Jesus' name. Amen. Our scripture for this morning comes from Ephesians chapter 5, verses 8 through 17. It reads, "For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Live as children of light, for the fruit of light consists in all goodness, righteousness, and truth. And find out what pleases the Lord. Have nothing to do with the fruitless deeds of darkness, but rather expose them. It is shameful even to mention what the disobedient do in secret, but everything exposed by light becomes visible, and everything that is illuminated becomes a light. This is why it is said, "Wake up, sleeper, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you." Be very careful then, how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Before I start the sermon today, I got to give a shout out to Colin. Colin, I just got to say, I hope that you are enjoying your Cocoa Puffs. Just don't enjoy them too loudly, because I know that you wouldn't want to distract me while I'm giving my sermon. After all, there are things to be learned today, right? Anyways, enjoy the Cocoa Puffs. When John Wesley would install or appoint a new pastor, he would give that pastor a book of 52 sermons that he had written. These sermons were supposed to be assisting this new pastor in fulfilling the new role that he was taking over as spiritual leader of a community of faith. The sermons had all sorts of topics about loving God, serving God, loving your neighbor, and being dedicated to a different lifestyle than the rest of the world, among a few other things. Now, there was one sermon there that we might think would be a little bit curious, though. And really a lot curious, because, you see, the sermon was titled, very strangely, at least for us today, the title was, On Redeeming the Time. Now, you might think that is strange, right? What in the world is this sermon going to be about? On redeeming the time. Well, amazingly, this sermon was all about going to bed on time and getting up in the morning on time. Still, I can't say it enough that today we might be puzzled about why this question was being asked in a religious setting. But the way we use our time was very important to John Wesley, and even though we cannot find any specific verse where God, our Creator, or Jesus would tell us to go to bed on time, this is a topic that has its roots in the discipline of faith. Remember, to be a Christian is to believe that Jesus died for us, and to accept Him as your Savior, and to live a life that would be free of sin. Now, of course, we all know that to be human is to not be perfect. We will sin. But that doesn't mean that we are supposed to embrace sin. You see, it means that we are supposed to be working each and every day to fight off sinful ways and to stay away from temptation. We're to fight off evil and to live a life that God would call holy. The word is discipline. Discipline is the name of the game, and these two questions that we're going to be evaluating today, these cover how we spend our time. For John Wesley, and that sermon that he wrote, he based that sermon and his reasoning about the discipline of sleeping and waking on one verse from Ephesians. This would be from Ephesians chapter 5, verse 16. Now, our version came from the New International Version, and it reads, "Making the most of every opportunity because the days are evil." John Wesley would have used the King James Version, which reads, "Redeeming the time because the days are evil." There it is, right? That's where he got his title. Now, we used a much larger passage from Ephesians, starting with verse 8, because it gives us a bit more direction and understanding of what we're going to talk about. You see, this passage is about identity and behavior, because identity and behavior go hand in hand, that if you know your identity, you'll know how to act. It starts out by saying that those who are reading it have been transformed. They've been transformed because they're Christian. At one point in time in their lives, they were actively living in a way that was not acceptable to God. They might not have even known that it was not acceptable because they didn't know it was sinful. But at one point in time, they didn't know anything. They were unrepentant sinners, as some people might say. And it likens their lives to be in darkness. Now, of course, light and dark have always been used as analogies for good and evil. But I would like to make one clarification about my statement that the readers were being described as transformed. You see, the readers were really being classified as Christian. As I said, at one point in time, they weren't. So they were introduced to Jesus and the message that he taught, and that is the real difference between them now and what they once used to be. Once you accept Jesus, it does not mean that you're going to be free from sin. It means that you're going to align yourself with Jesus Christ, that you are seeking to see the world through compassionate, forgiving, and sacrificial eyes of Jesus. You have chosen to enter into a way of life that seeks to remove sin. To do that, you must know what sin is, and you must be willing to be different. This passage tells us to reevaluate our lives so that we might be in the light of Christ, so that we can be children of light. So this leads us to that part that tells us to wake up so Christ can actually shine on us. Finally, it tells us to be careful, okay? Meaning that we really need to be aware, we need to be watchful. This means that we need to pay attention to what we are doing and pay attention to our actual behavior so that we can live lives that are wise, lives that understand what is good and what is not. So this leads me to the two questions. We're going to look at here 12 and 17. They're both about time. 12 is, do I go to bed on time and get up on time? And 17 is, how do I spend my spare time? They are about time. They're about behavior. First thing I'm going to say, though, is this. Let's understand that time is a blessing. It is. Because life is a blessing, and it is made up of seconds, minutes, hours, days, weeks, months, and years. Every moment is a gift from God. And for those of us who agree with this, those of us who believe that Jesus is our Savior, we have to look at our time differently than before we were Christian, before we believed. We truly should not want to waste our time. And being careful not to waste this blessing of time is precisely why John Wesley was so concerned about his own bedtime and wake-up time, and even in his spare time. He felt it was important for all of us to be concerned about our own time as well. And his argument would go something like this. A person of faith should only get the amount of sleep that they would absolutely need. They shouldn't get 1 minute more and not 1 minute less. He stated a truth in that sermon, actually, that doctors today would totally agree with. You will harm your health if you do not get enough sleep. Truly, you gotta get enough sleep. Because if you don't get enough sleep, it can cause all sorts of physical and mental issues, especially if you consistently deprive yourself of enough sleep. You see, your body and your life are a gift from God, and if you harm it, then you're not really treating these gifts with honor and reverence. And when we misuse those gifts, that falls into the category of sin. Therefore, according to John Wesley, you need to get enough sleep so that your body can be rested, so that it can heal itself, and so that you can be mentally ready for the day. You also, according to John Wesley, need to be certain not to oversleep, as that can cause multiple issues on the other side of things as well. First, sleeping too long would mean that you have wasted hours that could have been used to glorify God. Second, we all know it sure can feel good to get some extra sleep, right? I mean, we've all experienced that great feeling when you can just roll over and hit the snooze button once or twice or six times. Or maybe you just shut off the alarm and roll over and go, you know what, I'm really too tired, I'm just gonna sleep. That feels good, right? You know what I mean. But you know, it is easy to stay in bed. And it is easy to say it feels good to rest. But rising in the morning is about discipline, and discipline is not necessarily the easiest thing at all to engage in. Proverbs tells us that when we are seeking discipline, it's a burden. But man, after we've experienced it for an amount of time, it really pays off in times of trouble. So we're supposed to be people of discipline, and I don't mean that just because we are Methodists. Understand, also, John Wesley was called a Methodist because there was a method to everything. And he had his days structured very strictly so that he knew when he was going to do stuff because he didn't want to waste the gift that God had given him. And so for those of us who are Christians, we work to have disciplined lives. So it's not just Methodist, it's all of us who are going to be people of faith. We work to live disciplined lives that avoid sinful behavior and instead seek to share the love of Christ with the world. So Christians, we seek to transform the world into a bit of the kingdom of God in our midst. So further, let me just throw it out like this when it comes to the sleeping and how we spend our time. Imagine if you were to get one more hour of sleep than is necessary every single day. So that would mean that over the course of 1 week, you would have gotten 7 hours of sleep that you didn't need. That's 7 more hours. Now, does it do you any good? If it's more than what you needed, probably not. And remember, I'm saying one more hour than you needed. Not just one more than what you're currently getting, okay? I say that because so many of us don't get enough as it is. Now, if you're getting one more hour than what you needed, it might not hurt you, but definitely it wouldn't do you any good, right? Now think about what you could have done with those 7 extra hours during the week that you just slept through. Could you pick up a book and read it, maybe something that would enlighten you? Could you get in an extra walk or a run or a workout that would strengthen your body? How about this? Could you take those 7 hours and find a way to share Christ with someone who needs to hear about Jesus? Could you engage in ministry that would alleviate suffering for someone who is in need? Now, what do these questions reveal to you when you think about bedtimes and wake-up times in this way? Have you ever even thought about this? I would wager that many of us haven't put much thought into it. But we're not just talking about sleeping too little or too much. We are also concerned about the way we spend our spare time. Now, there is a song that I recall. It's called 5 o'clock World by Alan Reynolds. It was a very popular song, I think, in 1965, well before my time. But in the song, the singer is talking about the rat race and work and such. And he even sings one of the lines says that he's trading his time for the pay he gets. We sell the hours of our lives so that we can have money, so that we can provide shelter and food and the necessities of life. Because we sell our time, I feel like we often value our spare time, and sometimes we might overvalue it. You see, it's our free time, and no one else can tell us what to do because there's just not that much of it. But for the Christian, all of our time, both work and free, is important. It's a gift, remember. We really do need to look at how we're spending it. The question Of course, number 17 does look at just our spare time, but I really would implore you to take a look at all of your time. You see, we can sometimes be a slave to our work, or maybe we can be slave to not doing our work, to our free time. And we all know that you can look up statistics and it'll show that Americans seem to take the least amount of time for vacation, and that we constantly will work as if it is a badge of honor. Yes, we do all have obligations to fulfill, and we all have bills to pay, but please look at your work life. Look at it through the compassionate, forgiving, and sacrificial eyes of our Savior. Remember that the followers of Jesus, even the disciples, and we have examples from Scripture, they could get it wrong, and we could get it wrong, and we could easily have a different point of view from Jesus. So this is an important task. We really need to ask ourselves, am I doing what would be honoring of the Savior that I proclaim to believe in? Does my work lift other people up? Does my work harm? Does it maybe unnecessarily pull me away from what I should be doing and what should be important in my life? Now, these questions are extremely difficult because they get at things that we might have identified as being absolutely important, things that we just have to do, things that we would call obligations. But we do need to look at them. But further, what do I do in my spare time? That's question number 17. What am I doing in my spare time? How am I using it? Now, we can engage in things that are good for us, and we can engage in things that won't be. We can be engaged in things that can draw us away even just from the kingdom of God. So it's important for us to look at those things. Yes, we can have hobbies. Yes, we can have things that really bring us fulfillment. But we need to look at it and say, wait a minute. What are the actions that we're engaging in? And are they good, or do they draw us away from God? You know, in my time in ministry, I've run into folks, a lot of men actually, who love to go fishing. And I personally love to be fishing. Actually, this whole next week, I'm supposed to be on vacation, and I hope to be doing a lot of fishing. But I've had people who've told me, oh, I'm not going to be at church because my church is out on a boat. And I say, that's great. That's great. If you're actually spending some time in prayer, if you're actually getting out there and looking and reading through the Scripture and contemplating it as you're casting, right? You see, we really do need to take a serious look at what we do in our spare time, because, you know, we can actually use those hobbies to forward the kingdom of God. I have had parishioners, especially in some of my previous churches, who would love to be out on the water and doing things. And what's interesting to me is that there were those who would actually talk to me about how they had theological conversations with the guys that they were out there with, where they could actually talk about Scripture. But, you know, to do that, they actually had to know it. They actually had to read it, they had to study it, and they had to understand a little bit about it. Those are all things that this passage would call us to do when it comes to the behavior that it is, you know, asking us to look at. I mean, really, when you go ahead and you look at 15, 16, and 17. Remember, 16 was the one that John Wesley used in that sermon. But 15, it reads, be very careful. Be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. John Wesley was looking at those two parts of 16 and 17. Make the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. Can we take our spare time? Can we take our work time? Can we take the moments we get up in the morning and use those to understand God more? Can we use them to share God with others? can we use them to glorify God? So you see, that's why we would ask these questions. That's why we would look and say, do I get to bed on time and do I get up on time? Because quite frankly, I don't want to waste any of the life that God has given me. And how do I spend my spare time? Am I doing things that are healthy for me, that aren't robbing me of hours? Or am I doing things that do rob me of hours? If we had a better understanding of how we used our time, if we had a better understanding of how we could use it to glorify God, imagine what the world could look like. Imagine what your life could look like. These are the important questions. You might think that they would be silly that you would have specifically a question about bedtime and a question about spare time. But as you can see, they are extremely important for those of us who would proclaim faith in Christ. Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gifts that you have given to us. We thank you for simply the gift of life and time. There are so many seconds in the day. There are so many that we might just simply take them for granted. And in fact, there are so many that we might get distracted from you by all the different things that we might be seeking to engage in. Lord, call us home. Call us together. Call us back to you so that we might be able to learn your wisdom and understand your wisdom. Bring us together so that we might make sure that we would never waste the gift that you have given us. Make it so that we would glorify you. Make it so that we would share you. Make it so that we would spread the gospel to others using the time you've given us. Lord, we thank you and praise you in Christ's name. Amen. I want to take a moment to thank you for your continued support of New Philadelphia First United Methodist Church. Every week we continue to bring forth these at-home worship services as we eagerly anticipate being able to come back together. For when we're separated, there are things that we miss. And one of the things that I would have to say I miss actually is just simply the doxology that we sing during our third service here at church. Now, we sing number 94, which is actually a different version than what I've sang in many of the churches that I've served. It says, "Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. Alleluia. Alleluia. Praise God, the source of all our gifts. Praise Jesus Christ, who power uplifts. Praise the Spirit, Holy Spirit. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia." Now, I didn't sing that because I can't sing very well. But when we gather together and we are able to hear that sang, to me, it's beautiful. We do that because we are thanking our God, as it says, who is the source of all our gifts. I thank you for your continued support of New Philadelphia First United Methodist Church. I would encourage you to remember us in your family's budget, for we still have work that's being done. We have bills that we're paying. And we do seek to share the gifts that God is bestowing upon us with our community. For we do exist to make and mature disciples of Christ for the transformation of the world. This doesn't happen without your support. And so I thank you for remembering us in your budget. Remember, you can go online to give. There is a video on our website. You can also mail us a check here to the church, or you can drop it off. Most days there are people here until noon. But at this time, I do thank you for your continued support, and I'd ask you to pray with me. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you that even during this time of quarantine, or at least this time where we are socially distancing, that you have been still faithful to us, and so we seek to remain faithful. We thank you for the offering. that is sent in each and every week. We thank you for the difference that it makes, and just pray that your blessing would be upon those offerings, that they would be used to further your kingdom within our community and this world. We thank you in Christ's name. Amen.
Hi, church family. I'm Shauna Hinkle, and I attend the 10:45 worship service with my husband Fred and daughter Emma. I'd like to share an update from our reopening task force meeting this week. First, we want to thank you for your faithfulness leading up to face-to-face worship. The task force members are planning to do a trial run of our plans to assure they meet safety guidelines and expectations. Currently, the East Ohio Conference is in phase two, allowing small group meetings. We want to be prepared when Bishop Tracy Malone moves the conference into phase three, allowing face-to-face worship.
All who are looking down, holding on to hearts still wounding. Those who've yet to find in places near where love is moving. Cast off the robe you're wearing, set aside the names that you've been given. Lay this place of rest, fold of your journey, bind you to hold. We will never walk alone. In the shelter of each other, we will live, we will live. In the shelter of each other, we will live, we will stone. There's hope, we know the rocks will cry out. And the tears aren't ours alone, let them fall into the hands that hold us. Come away from where you're hiding, set aside the lies that you've been living. In this place of rest, hold of your journey, bind you to hope. You will never walk alone. In the shelter of each other, we will live, we will live. In the shelter of each other, must all believe our lives are not our own. We all belong. God has given us each other, and we will never walk alone. In the shelter of each other, we will live, we will live. In the shelter
I thank you for joining us today for worship. I pray that as you go out into the world this week, that you would be able to take a bit of the message of Jesus Christ with you, that you could share it with others so that they might know the love of Christ. And now I leave you with these words from the book of Numbers chapter 6. This is the priestly blessing. May the Lord bless you and protect you. May the Lord smile up on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord show you his favor and give you his peace. Amen. God is good and all the time. Amen.